Let's take a look at getting started in Rainbow. We'll be covering some essential areas that will allow you to get up and running quickly, and a number of resources that will allow you to have the best possible patching experience. Patching in Rainbow will feel familiar to Mac's users. We instantiate objects in the same way and join them together using patch cords. The difference is that we need to be working inside of the Rainbow Tilde object that we have instantiated inside of a Max patcher in a similar fashion to Jan. Inside the Rainbow Tilde object, you will need to make inlet and outlet objects for audio signals, MIDI, and event messages. This will allow you to interact with your Rainbow code from the top level Max patch using attributes, data controls, and audio input and output. It's worth noting that Rainbow is vector-based, like MSP. A key difference between Rainbow and Max is that events are time-stamped and sample-accurate inside of Rainbow. Within Rainbow, you can use gen the same way that you do in Max by making a gen object inside of a Rainbow Tilde patcher. You are still going to want to implement your low-level filters, delays, and reverb-based patches inside of here, as well as anything using CodeBox. Rainbow includes many familiar objects to those that have used Max before. Just like Max, every object includes its own help file that often has multiple tabs and examples that allow you to cut and paste the code directly into your own Rainbow patch. Along with these, there are references and guides for each object. It's also worth noting that any previously created gen patching you may have laying around or built-in gen examples are basically drop-in ready. Let's take a look at the new sidebar icons inside of the Rainbow Tilde patching environment. The first five icons in the bottom toolbar starting from the left will be familiar to Max users. If they're not, be sure to check out the Max for Rainbow video for further explanations. The first unique Rainbow toolbar icon is the sixth icon from the left. It looks like two semicircle arrows. This allows you to turn off and on auto compilation. This feature can be useful when building very complex patches. You may like to wait and manually compile at a more suitable time. However, most of the time you are likely to want to leave autocompile on, the default state. When we turn off autocompile and change something in the patcher, the hammer icon will light up yellow to indicate changes have been made since the last compilation. To recompile our patch and commit new changes, we need to manually click on the hammer icon. When you do this, you will see a blue build status progress bar to the right light up with a generating and compiling text. If unsuccessful, you will see a message, error, and the Max console sidebar icon will display a red dot. If you open the console, there will be more details outlining the error and indicators on what you need to change to recompile without the error. The next icon to the right, we have a Paperclip Plus icon. Like in Max, it's possible to make snippets of Rainbow patching for quick and easy access in the future. The next icon in the Rainbow Patcher toolbar is the transport icon. Rainbow is able to sync to Max's global transport and supports locking to an external timing source. Perhaps the most notable icon inside of the Rainbow Patcher is in the right side toolbar. It looks like a page with an arrow. This is the export sidebar icon and a gateway to a range of external target destinations for your Rainbow patch. Here you will find all of the target options where your Rainbow code can be sent. These include C++ export, Max external export, Raspberry Pi, VST and AU plugin, and web export possibilities. Be sure to check out the other videos in the Rainbow Path series for detailed coverage of each export target. RNBO has dedicated objects called Param for events and Param tilde for signals that you'll want to get to know. Params are a way to expose your internal RNBO functionality back to your top-level Max patcher. Once you set a param in your RNBO patch, you can control it from Max using prepend and the param name or the attribute UI object. Params have another important functionality in RNBO. They allow you to expose these parameter controls to the outside world when exporting to external targets. Setting these in your RNBO patch will allow these parameters to be controlled in your exported target. If you would like more details on params, check out the video Parameters and Presets. Just like Max, RNBO has snapshots. These are created in a similar fashion to the way we create them in Max. Connecting a param object to a UI object means that the value is recalled when we change snapshots. However, if the UI element is before the parameter, it is not recalled with the snapshot. One of the great things about snapshots being included in RNBO is that they can be embedded inside of your code when exporting to targets. This allows you to create a number of different states that can be recalled from the external target. In RNBO, there are some new ways of controlling attributes that can be broken down into two categories. Those that are settable after compilation, such as changing the loop points on a groove object, we call these options. And those that must be set before object compilation, like the minimum and maximum amounts in a parameter object, we call these properties. It's important you familiarize yourself with these, as they will greatly affect your workflow and user experience when you've completed your RNBO patch, especially considering whether or not your RNBO patcher is exported to an external target, at which point properties are fixed. To learn more about a specific section of RNBO, check out the technical videos. If you're interested in exporting your RNBO code, take a look at the external target videos. And if you're interested to see how to build a complete RNBO patcher, see the project section in the RNBO Paths video series. Happy patching!